Can an epidemic permanently shape a city's landscape? Does it affect whether and how residents are segregated long after the disease itself has faded? On the one hand, illness and disease often entail serious economic hardship, whether through direct medical costs or by reducing a household's wage-earning capacity. This suggests that geographically concentrated shocks can give rise to pockets of urban poverty by simultaneously impoverishing a large fraction of a neighborhood's residents. At the same time, illness has no direct effect on infrastructure or land or other permanent attributes of a neighborhood, and so it seems likely that any negative effects would dissipate over time as existing residents leave and new ones enter. This paper traces out the long-run effects of an epidemic by studying the London cholera outbreak of 1854. Over the course of just 1 month, 660 residents living in the half-mile radius of St. James Parish died from cholera, implying that 5% of families lost a potential wage earner. Even more acutely, the impact was concentrated in a single neighborhood within the parish, where 13% of families were affected. Did this localized outbreak affect the spatial distribution of poverty in the long run? First, some background. St. James Parish, which constitutes the Soho neighborhood in London today, was in 1854 a working-class neighborhood with 35,000 residents. The vast majority were renters, and the parish was the most densely populated in the city, with 432 people per acre, and many buildings housing multiple families. In August 1854, the parish experienced a sudden outbreak of cholera. While the source of the disease was unknown at the time, it was later traced back to contaminated groundwater from the Broad Street pump, one of the 13 wells serving the parish. Because this was the central source of transmission, the outbreak was largely concentrated within the catchment area of the affected pump, and exposure to the disease was much higher within that neighborhood. While 3% of the overall St. James population died, the analogous figure was 8% within the Broad Street catchment. This figure shows the probability of having at least one death in the household. To the left are houses falling 0 to 100 meters outside the catchment area, while to the right are those falling 0 to 100 meters from the boundary inside the affected region. There is a sharp increase in this probability just inside the boundary, and the authors estimate that the average number of deaths was approximately 3 times higher inside the catchment. This discontinuity suggests a strategy for estimating the causal effect of the outbreak. If exposure differs sharply on either side of the boundary, but other attributes don't, properties just outside the boundary can serve as a control group for those just inside the boundary. On this point, it's important to note that catchment areas do not correspond to any meaningful administrative unit within the St. James Parish. In fact, they are defined only by households' travel distance to the nearest well. This means that households located just on either side of the boundary should not differ in any meaningful way aside from their exposure to the outbreak. And the authors show this to be true for a number of variables, including property values, their main outcome of interest, as measured in 1853, prior to the outbreak. So, what consequences did the outbreak have for the distribution of poverty within this neighborhood? The results show that when measured a decade after the epidemic, there is an 18% drop in rental prices right at the boundary. Over this period, properties right inside the catchment area experienced an 11 to 13% loss in value. Notably, this applies even to properties that did not experience a cholera death. The epidemic reduced the value of all properties in the neighborhood, not just those hit by the disease. What is especially striking, however, is that these sharp differences in property values are not only apparent 10 years after the epidemic, they persist for the following 150 years and show no signs of converging. This, despite the fact that by the late 19th century, piped water became widely available, rendering these boundaries completely irrelevant. Nonetheless, there continued to be a sharp drop in property values inside the boundary, and, as measured in 1899, a higher incidence of household poverty. What explains these results? The authors show that shortly after the epidemic, there was a significant increase in residential crowding within the catchment. This is consistent with historic accounts that families impoverished by the death of a wage earner often took in short-term tenants to make up the financial shortfall. Recall, however, that St. James was already the most densely populated parish in London prior to the outbreak. Further crowding would have given rise almost immediately to negative externalities that dragged down surrounding property values. If enough properties are negatively affected, the authors show it is possible to settle into a long-term equilibrium in which it is optimal for landlords to attract and retain poor tenants rather than try to attract rich ones. Consistent with this, migration data in the post-outbreak period show that the degree of neighborhood impoverishment within the catchment encouraged those unaffected by the epidemic to leave while the affected stayed. In conclusion, this paper provides evidence that the localized economic effects of the 1854 epidemic can still be seen in modern-day London. This provides one example of how even temporary shocks can have a permanent effect on a city's urban landscape. To read more on this topic, you can check out the full paper and its references to other related work. This includes research on the drivers of long-run income differences across space, papers studying externalities in real estate markets, and a theoretical literature modeling location choice and segregation.